goodness with care from our villages Arokya milk.
Welcome to episode 3 of the Mahabharata with Anuja. Very glad you could join me today. Now, as we saw, Satyavati and Shantanu had been married for quite a while and they had two sons. Their names were Chitrangada and Vichitravirya. Shantanu passed away after that, and it was Bhishma who raised these boys as if they were his own sons. And while they were still minors, he acted as the regent. But he was also grooming them, especially Chitrangada, the elder one. Bhishma took him under his wing and he raised him so that he would be an excellent king. Now they say that Chitrangada showed a lot of promise, but something very unfortunate happened. Chitrangada was becoming very famous and he was showing a lot of talent, and a Gandharva, whose name was also Chitrangada, was very envious because people knew the Kshatriya prince Chitrangada more than they knew him. So he challenged this prince to a duel, and they say that the two of them fought for 3 long years, but at the end of it, Chitrangada, the Kuru prince, was killed, and Bhishma was very, very heartbroken about it because he would have been a very good king. Now, Vichitravirya was the next in line, but this prince had a wasting disease, something like consumption, and he was quite weak, but he was the next in line, so Bhishma was training him as well. And when he came of age, it was decided by him and Satyavati that they should get him married quickly so that they would have worthy heirs. And they cast about for a suitable match, and they settled on the 3 princesses of Kasi. Their names were Amba, Ambika and Ambalika, and all were very beautiful and accomplished and really nice girls, so they decided to go for it. And since Vichitravirya wasn't really capable of travelling too far, I guess, Bhishma decided he would go in his stead and win these princesses and bring them back. When he arrived at the Swayamvara, all the warriors gathered there were quite tickled to see him. And they said, okay, isn't he a little too old to be here? And second of all, he's taken a vow of celibacy. So what's he doing here? And they started teasing him, his manhood. And Bhishma got very angry. He stood up. He said, I'm more man than all of you put together. So always these things were there, I guess. And Bhishma forcibly carried away these 3 princesses. And all the warriors followed him. But of course, they were no match for this peerless warrior. And King Shalva, his name is Shalva, he gave him a good fight, but at the end of it, Bhishma defeated him and he was close to killing him, and Amba begged him to spare this king's life. So Bhishma very graciously agreed, and the 3 princesses were taken to Hastinapura, and Bhishma began preparations for the wedding. Now, Amba, very slowly, she approached Bhishma and Satyavati, and she said, see, the whole point of a Swayamvara is that we get to choose our mates, and I had already chosen Shalva, and he loves me too. So, do the right thing, do the honourable thing. And Bhishma sent her back with a very suitable guard and an escort, and Amba went with so much love in her heart because she wanted to be reunited with Shalva. But Shalva's reception was far from warm. He said, what are you doing here? And she said, we are promised to each other. Let's get married. And he said, because of you only, I was defeated in this embarrassing way by Bhishma. And because you begged him, he gave my life back to me. I feel like a beggar who's received alms, and I've lost the respect of everyone. And every time I see your hateful face, I'm reminded of this incident. So please don't show your face to me again. You go back and you marry that Bhishma. And this beautiful princess who'd had so much dreams and hopes, it was all shattered in an instant, and she didn't know what to do. She was proud, so she didn't beg him to marry her. Quietly, she returned to Hastinapura and she told Bhishma what had happened. And it was very painful for her to tell all this to him. And Bhishma felt very sorry because he felt guilty, and rightly so. So he spoke to Vichitravirya and he said, why don't you marry her also? And Vichitravirya, this weak princeling, he says, no, she had another man in her heart, so I will not marry her. So he was being a big time jerk, basically. And poor Amba was rejected again. And this time, again, though she hated to do it, in those days, I think being a single woman was even more ridiculously difficult than it is today. So poor Amba, once more, she had to swallow her pride, and this time she approached Bhishma. Now, Bhishma, he would have married her if he could have, but he told her, see, I would love to help you. Ask me for anything. I will do anything to make amends, but I cannot marry you. You know about my vow. Please don't ask this of me. And at that point, since he was the third person to reject her, I think Amba decided that he was responsible for everything that had gone wrong in her life, and she left in anger, and she was wandering from here to there, and she didn't know what to do. So it was a very, very horrible time in her life, and she came across Parashurama in his ashram. He was Bhishma's preceptor, and she told him everything what had happened, and Parashurama sympathized with her. He said, I'll send for Bhishma, he will listen to me. And when Parashurama summoned Bhishma, Bhishma said the same thing. You're my guru, I will obey anything you ask of me, but don't ask this. I cannot break my oath. And then immediately Parashurama challenged him to a duel. And these two mighty heroes had this great clash, and the gods gathered to watch. But at the end of it, neither prevailed over the other. They were too good. So it was declared a draw, and Amba was super disgusted, and she walked away from both of them again. And this time she performed penances, and she propitiated Subramanya. That is another name is Kartikeya or Murugan. And this god appeared before her, and he gave her a garland of ever fresh lotuses. He said, find someone who will wear this garland. They will be that person will be your champion and bring about the death of Bhishma. And Amba again, she went from kingdom to kingdom looking for a champion, but nobody had the guts to piss off Bhishma basically, because he was too good. And Amba finally, she went to Drupada's kingdom in Panchala, and there also she was sent away. So she was sick of all the men, can you blame her? She was sick of the lot of them. She just left the garland there at the entrance to Panchala, and she disappeared into the forest, and she did even more severe penances. And this time Shiva appeared before her. He said, don't worry, in your next life you will retain all your memory of what had happened. I don't see how that's a boon, because these are all horrible memories. He said, you will take birth again, and you will be responsible for Bhishma's death. And it came to be that Amba wanted her next life to begin. There was so much anger and hatred there, so she entered the flames, and her last thought was, you know, I'm going to get Bhishma for this. And she was born as King Drupada's daughter. Now, when she was very small, she was running around playing. Other girls, I suppose, in those days, they had very strict activities assigned for girls, so mainly dolls, right? But this girl was different. She ran out and she picked up this garland, this which Subramanya had given Amba, and she put it on. And Drupada was horrified, because now the spies would carry the news back to Bhishma, and he didn't want a war with the Kurus. So Drupada was talking with his ministers, and they were all saying, let's abandon this girl, this precocious girl in the forest. And at that point, a divine voice was heard, and they said, this warrior will be the destroyer of Bhishma. And so Drupada again, he changed acts, and he raised this girl as a boy, because apparently in those days only to be a warrior you had to be a man or something like that. So they raised this girl as a boy, and when she came of age, they even found a princess from Dasarna to be wed to her. And then there was a huge, very ugly controversy, because this princess found out the truth about Drupada's daughter, and she complained to her father, and both the kingdoms came to the brink of war, because her father, King Hiranyavarna, said, I will send my personal physicians to ascertain whether you lied to us and under false pretenses made this union happen. And Drupada was trying to pacify them, and they say at this point this child of his, she contemplated killing herself, because everyone kept treating her like a freak, and they were all proud of Draupadi and Rishtadyumna, but nobody even mentioned this child, okay? Everyone thought she was too weird and a freak, basically. So this poor child, this person went off into the forest, and she met a very sympathetic yaksha. His name was Tunakarna, and when he heard all this, he very kindly agreed to give her his male organs in exchange for her female organs. And when she emerged from the forest, it was as Shikandin, the warrior, destined to slay Bhishma. Now the spies carried all these news to Bhishma, but he just said, I know the truth about her, I know who she is, and I will never ever fight her, I will never pick up arms against her. And he had a lot on his plate, so he just dropped this, and he started, as usual, he was concentrating on his duties, and you know, he was hoping that there would be hairs and there won't be any issues on that score. But unfortunately for all of them, Vichitravirya passed away at a very young age from his illness, and he was without issue. His wives hadn't conceived yet, and it was a big crisis. And Satyavati said, at least now, you know, we can't just leave the throne empty like this. It's your duty. You marry your brother's, half-brother's wives, and you know, you should produce hairs. Bhishma said, why is everyone trying to convince me to break my oath? I cannot do this, and we have to think of some other option. So Satyavati thought long and hard about it, and finally she confided in Bhishma. Their relationship was very sweet and they worked very well together. So Satyavati told him something she hadn't told anyone. She said, while I was still a young girl, while I was still a fisherwoman carrying people on my ferry across the river Yamuna, I met a sage named Parashara, and he fell in love with me, and he wanted to be with me like that. And I said, I'm unwed, I'd rather not do this. So he promised to give me a son, and he said I would also, you know, remain, you know, very respectable and all this. So, and he would have also blessed her with the fragrance she became very famous for. So Satyavati had agreed, and she'd had a son who was none other than Vyasa. She said, my son has become very famous now. He's classified the Vedas, and they now call him Veda Vyasa. And he promised to always come to my help. So all I have to do is think of him and my son will come to me. Let's ask him to bless these girls with children. There's nothing wrong with it. It's the Niyoga practice. A woman who doesn't have children can, you know, approach a man who's either her husband's equal or his superior to have sons in his name. So I think they did a lot of things like this. You know, think of it as in vitro fertilization, something like that, sperm donation, stuff like that. So she went ahead and summoned her son, and Vedavyasa appeared, and he agreed to do what was asked of him. He said, but there are certain purification rituals which these princesses should follow. Satyavati said, please don't start all your nonsense and all. We need to have children real quickly, so don't delay. And Vedavyasa said, then these girls will have to accept me exactly as I am, which meant, you know, he'd lived in the forest, he'd been meditating, he hadn't bathed in long years, so let's just say he didn't smell very nice, and that was the least of it. He was like really gross, basically. So these princesses had been instructed by Satyavati that, you know, they would be visited by a suitor, and they were expecting Bhishma, the extremely good-looking Bhishma. But when Ambika saw who had entered her chamber, she was quite horrified, and she shut her eyes, and so the child born to her was blind, and he was named Dhritarashtra. Satyavati called her son and she said, why would you pull a stunt like this on me? How can I place a blind man on the throne? Bless Ambalika also with a son. And Ambalika also was quite repelled with the great sage's appearance, and but she handled herself better than her sister. And they say she became very pale, the blood just drained from her features. And so Pandu, the pale one, was born. And Satyavati said, okay, we have a hare and a spare, but we can never have too many spares, so please bless us with one more son. And again, she called Ambika, and she said, okay, you will prepare yourself to receive the sage. And Ambika decided that she'd had enough of Vedavyasa, so she sent her maid in her place, and a son was born to them. And Vedavyasa blessed her and said that her son will be very wise and a very good man. He was named Vidura. Now, Vidura has a very interesting backstory, and it went like this. There was a sage named Mandavya, and one day he'd been in his ashram. He was performing severe penances when a bunch of robbers broke into his ashram. They were being chased by the king's men, and seeing that this sage was in a yogic trance, they hid all their loot in his ashram and they ran away from there. And he was so far gone, he didn't even know they'd come and gone. And when the king's men came there, they looked around, they found the loot, and they reported back to the king and said, this fellow, he's pretending to be a sage, but he's actually the chief of robbers. And the king gave instructions that he should be punished. So these soldiers very cruelly, they impaled him and left him to die. But his yogic merit was so great that he did not die, and he was just in a whole lot of pain. And all the forest dwellers gathered there and they said, how could this happen to sage Mandavya? He's so noble, why should he suffer like this? And Mandavya himself asked Dharma or Yama. He called him and said, why? What have I done to deserve such excruciating pain? And Yama said, as a youngster, you used to torture and kill birds and animals. So this is the punishment you get for that. And he said, see, I was a clueless, ignorant boy. I was cruel then, but I've changed. And this punishment is extremely disproportionate to the crime. So you will also pay for this. And he cursed Yama and he said he will have to suffer the slings and arrows of fate and be born as a mortal. So they say Vidura is Yama reborn. And Yudhishthira and Vidura would be very, very close because another name for Yudhishthira was Dharmaputra. So that's why they somehow got along and they had a certain bond. Now, the three boys were born. The line had been perpetuated after a lot of effort. And I will conclude today's session of the Mahabharata. I hope you liked it. I can't wait to hear your comments about the ancient Niyoga practice. Do share it with me. And don't forget to press like, share and to subscribe to our channel. I will see you soon with another cracking episode of the Mahabharata. Thank you very much.
Goodness with care. From our villages, Arokya Milk.